we have seven really fascinating speakers for you in the next session, so we'd like to kick off. My name is Paul Anglum. I'm with an initiative called BioInnovate Ireland, delighted to moderate this morning. We'll get straight into the talks. We have, I believe, 10 minutes per speaker, and so we'd like to start with Stephen O'Reilly from Enterprise Ireland. Welcome, Stephen.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, everybody. Particularly, I would like to thank Jane, who mentioned this to me quite a while back, I think, at this stage. And to be honest, I had kind of quite forgotten about it until I got the reminder a couple of weeks ago. So kind of a bit of last minute panic to put a presentation together for this. My name is Stephen O'Reilly. I'm with Enterprise Ireland, and I am a delegate and contact point for the Horizon programme. And in particular, I'm looking after ICT and an area called FET, FET, Future and Emerging Technologies. And I also look after a separate European programme called Excel, which I will briefly mention here as well, because there might be some little bit of interest in that for you. Excel stands for Electronic Components and Systems for European Leadership. So very quickly, I guess you're all familiar with this picture. This is the overall structure of Horizon 2020. As you know, it's launched in 2014, it's going to run until 2020, a budget in the ballpark of about 80 billion. Sounds like a lot of money, but by the time you go through all the different parts of the programme, you'll find out it doesn't really go very far. Okay? We have three main pillars: excellent science, industrial leadership, and societal challenges. Now, I guess most people here will be familiar with the societal challenges area, and in particular, the first societal challenge on health, demographic change, and well-being. But I suppose the message I'd like to get across here is that there are opportunities across all three pillars for people in the room here today. In particular, if we look at excellent science, we've got the European Research Council, which is funding individual fellowships, future and emerging technologies, which is really very, very early stage foundational research, collaborative research, where you do need partners, but it's very early stage, it's high risk, high potential impact, and what they're really looking for here would be, you know, multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary types of projects, and particularly looking for disciplines that traditionally would not have collaborated with each other previously. Okay. Now, as I say, it's very early stage research, and because it's completely bottom up, anything goes in terms of the scope, and one of the consequent problems of that is it would be that it does have a very low success rate. Okay, so something to be aware of when you're going in here. I mean, the success rate isn't single low single digit numbers. You know, the last batch of results we had was in the region of 2%. Okay, so while there are opportunities there for everybody, you know, somebody has to win, but you know, it's a tough ask. Excel, which I'll briefly mention as well. Excel is what is known as a joint undertaking. So it's components and systems for European leadership, but it's a programme that where participants avail of both national funding and EU funding. And the reason I mention it is because if you look at the focus of it, and this is just a very quick snapshot, we have a number of vertical pillars looking at the essential capabilities for the micro and nano electronics industries and the smart systems industries, but cross-cutting those on a horizontal level, we have key application areas, and smart health is in there as one of the application areas that the programme is focusing on. I just want to quickly mention two projects that are up and running from that programme. One of them is a project called InfraMed, and it has a Limerick company in there called Fleming Medical, and within that project they're developing smart bandages for wound care applications. So they're building in sensors and electronics into bandages. So you can see the health applications there straight away. The second project I'll quickly mention has another Irish company in there called Cregana. And one of the use cases they're looking within the second project is smart catheters. So again, they're building electronics and sensors into the tips of catheters. Okay. So even though it might look like a very micro, nano, smart systems type of program, there are opportunities in there for a wide range of different disciplines to get involved. So, you know, I mentioned the smart health, we've also smart mobility, we've got smart cities, smart society, energy, and smart production. So these next couple of slides, I suppose these are headings which I was provided with to maybe say a few words on. The first one is creating and or being part of interdisciplinary networks and consortia. meeting, contacting suitable partners and so on. I think the most important thing here is dialogue. You know, you do need to get out and talk to people. You need to talk to your colleagues. You know, within each of your organisations, I mean, if we just look at NUIG here, for example, you know, there's lots of people within the college here who have been successful in different parts of the programme, who've built up lots of experience over the years. And, you know, for any newcomer to the programme, you know, the research office will be able to give you the list of names of people who've done it before, sit down with them, have a cup of coffee with them, chat through the process. You know, potentially they could even collaborate with you within the one proposal. National contact points, we have a big group of national contact points here in Ireland. As I said, I look after ICT myself, and FET. Kay here is looking after the Health Societal Challenge. So do come and talk to us. You know, particularly for the newcomers, I think with the newcomers is where we can add most value, getting people up the chain fairly quickly. Project officers in the European Commission. I suppose there has been a sense that the Commission is distancing itself from researchers a little bit. They're trying to put more of the onus back on the contact points. But what you'll find is if you go to some of the Commission events, if you go to their brokerage information days, most of these project officers are more than happy to chat with you informally, explain what they're really looking for. And you know, even to this day, lots of them will still discuss proposal ideas with you, even though technically they're not supposed to, but they will in an informal setting. And look, it's in their interest to get as good a quality of proposal as possible, because at the end of the day, they're going to be the project officer that's going to be in charge of monitoring the project as it goes along. Identify the best partners. You know, you want to give yourself the best chance you possibly can going into this program. It takes a lot of work and effort to put in a good proposal. You know, you don't want to be bringing in freeloaders in there. You don't want to be bringing in people who've got bad reputations and who haven't done well in the past. You know, and again, the only way you will identify the best partners out there is by talking to your colleagues, looking at the projects that are up and running already, look at the projects that are doing well, see who's involved and see what they're doing. Networking, we heard mentioned earlier. You know, does an event like this, you'll meet people. The Commission is constantly organising events around particular topics. They can be quite broad. It could be ICT in general. It could be health in general. But they also organise more focused topics where you can go out and meet similar types of people who are looking to get involved in consortia and build proposals. ETPs, European Technology Platforms, there's a whole load of these groupings across Europe. They have strategic research agendas. A lot of them feed directly into the text of the work programme. You know, they're the people behind the topics to a certain extent, and they're the people that know where all of these topics are going, who's interested in them, and so on. So I think, you know, identify the most relevant platforms for you and follow them. You don't need to join up. You don't need to go to all their events, but get on their mailing list. Just be aware of what they're doing, and if there is a suitable event, well and good. Identifying calls. Well, look, there's no easy way around this. You basically have to go through the work programmes. Identify the topics. We're in a situation in Horizon where we have multi-annual work programmes. So at the start of year one, you know what's coming up for the next 2 years. So it's easy to identify these things in advance. Go to the information days, as I say, that the Commission organises. Talk to us, the national contact points. You know, we're familiar with what's in the work programmes. And a lot of the different units in the Commission have newsletters that they send out maybe on a monthly basis. Sign up for those. Preparing the application. Well, the most important thing here is to prepare early. You know, get your draft proposal together as soon as you can. Be ruthless. And what I mean by that is if you have partners in the consortium that are not doing their bit, get rid of them. There's too much at stake here to have people in there that aren't doing their fair share of the work. If they're not doing it for the proposal, what are they going to be like if you get a project? You know? Get independent views and opinions. There's lots of people here in the college who will have acted as evaluators on behalf of the Commission. You know, get them to read your proposal, but they can only do that if you have it ready early. There's no point in getting them to read it 2 days before the deadline. We have the Enterprise Ireland Coordinator grant for anyone that's thinking of leading a project. And think beyond the proposal. You're putting all this time and effort into a project, into a proposal. What are you going to get out of it if it's not funded? You know, you need to think about these extra benefits. Think of the relationships you're building with the partners. Will they be able to pull you into something in the future? Very quickly, just to finish up, I just want to highlight three topics here that are in the ICT work programme for a deadline next April, and just to show the possibility of health-related researchers getting involved here. The first one is in the big data space. Large-scale pilots in sectors best benefiting from data-driven innovation. And one of the specific target application areas I mentioned there is health. Okay. In the robotics area, we have a topic on system abilities, benchmarking, and safety certification. And one of the examples they give there is robotics for healthcare and elderly or handicapped people. Okay. So again, you can fit in there with that. And finally, photonics, the last example I'll give. We have a topic in there looking at biophotonics, with imaging systems for in-depth disease diagnosis. So again, you might naturally look to the ICT work programme, but there are opportunities in there. I think this is my last slide. I just want to plug an event happening in 2 weeks' time in Bratislava. It's a ICT proposals day. It covers all of the ICT-related topics in the work programme, and as you can see, some of those have opportunities for health researchers. So this is happening on the 26th and 27th of September in Bratislava. There'll probably be about 1,500 people at the event. Okay, it's worth considering. We have an EI travel grant available as well for people that want to go. And finally, just my contact details there and a few sources of further information. Okay, thank you.
Stephen, thank you very much. Next, I'd like to welcome Professor Tim O'Brien to the stage. Tim is the director of the Regenerative Medicine Institute here at NUI Galway and the dean of the College of Medicine. Thank you, Tim.
Thanks very much, and thanks to the organizers. Brave having 7 by 10 minute presentations, and I'll try to keep an eye on the warnings. I've used the template that Valerie provided. Some of the roles I fulfill are there. I've done this to try and stick to 10 minutes because I think the template was well put together from that perspective. So the first thing I was asked to do is introduce myself, who I am, what I do, and then focus a lot on process thereafter. So I'm a diabetologist, so I look after patients with diabetes, and there's no greater human endeavor which has greater interdisciplinarity than diabetes. So you start off with an advantage when you're working in an area such as diabetes, which has protein manifestations and 600 million predicted sufferers within the next 20 years. I direct a GMP facility, so we have a unique facility here that can make stem cells for human administration. And unique selling points are important in any proposal you're going to put forward. So in addition to the lab-based program I have in, I'm interested in diabetic complications and the use of stem cells to treat diabetic complications. And we've translated that now into the clinical trial arena. I'm currently coordinator of 2 EU-funded projects. One came from the last of FP7, and the other was the first of Horizon 2020. So I'll give a brief narrative around those 2 projects, not so much what's involved in them, but the process aspects of it. So Red Star is the first. It's called Reducing Diabetic Damage Through Stromal Cell Administration. So we work with a novel stromal cell, which can be isolated from bone marrow, and we spun out a company which has IP around how to isolate those stem cells. Is there something about to die here? That's not me now, that's the program. So we utilize this novel stem cell with an SME partner, which I'm a director of, across 6 diabetic complications, and then pick one complication halfway through the program which progresses to a clinical trial. And that's in process at the moment. The second EU consortium is called NEPHSTROM, and NEPHSTROM uses the same technology and applies it to one specific diabetic complication, which is kidney disease. And essentially, it was the data that supported NEPHSTROM came out of Red Star. So in those 6 complications, one complication went into a clinical trial within Red Star, and then there was data from a second complication in the animal models that allowed us to submit for this second project called NEPHSTROM. We're again developing the technology, so the underlying stem cell application, the novelty of that, is being the picture up there on your right of a new system. So each time the suggestion is you develop the technology and apply it to conditions which are common and very prevalent in Europe. I just, again, using the template that was provided to me, the partners, networks, and consortia. In fact, I'm just reminded as well that if I was given 10 minutes to talk about all the bids I failed, I wouldn't get it in. So I can talk about the two that I'm leading that were successful in the briefer period of time. But in this specific one, the call, we first identified it, and then we identified the partner. So we can go ahead and set up a network and then look for a call. We found a call and then set up the network. You need to decide what's unique about the approach and how it will solve the problem identified in the call. I think the comments from the first speaker in relation to finding partners is important, looking at PubMed and keeping an eye on geographic spread. But the most important thing is that the team makes sense, that you have a unique approach to solve a common problem, that you can be convincing, and that you're the best team assembled to address this problem. So the team is important. The interface between academia, business, and the clinic was very important for us. And the business part being particularly important, I think, within Horizon 2020. So as I said, we have a spin-out company called Orpson Therapeutics, which has a patented novel technology to isolate stem cells. So that gives you a good intro into writing your novelty section. And then the interdisciplinarity was also important. In terms of identifying the most suitable calls, I rely on things like the national contact points and colleagues in the research office. We analyze the topic and the call in detail and then seek support from EI. Pintail was mentioned by the first speaker. I'll mention it again. Kieran Clisman should be paying us, I suppose, but he's absolutely superb in marketing the bid. So you can put a science bid together but not have it funded under EU, even if it is excellent. Identify suitable partners through own sources or local national European agencies. Time was mentioned, so leave enough time to develop it. We establish a face-to-face meeting of all the partners before putting the bid in London. So we just met in an airport. We discussed what we were going to do, and that was very helpful. And leave enough time for detailed review comment from those independent of the proposal. So final tips to keep within, I may even be shorter than 10 minutes. Find a relevant call. Read the call carefully. That sounds obvious, but there's nuance. There's not a word in that call which isn't relevant to the EU Commission. Go for it, I said, even if the timeline suggests you should not, because you may not have another call specifically within your area. Identify clearly the unique selling points and assemble a team to deliver on the objective of the call. Be ambitious, but realize you'll be held to your proposed deliverables if successful. So there's this balance between reality and ambition, and but the deliverables you set will come back to haunt you. Seek help from the NCP, support from EI, a Pintail-like organization. I'm sure there are many of them out there, but they're crucial. An SME partner or partners is crucial. In my experience, we now have 5 consortia funded by or supported by REMEDI PIs, coordinated by REMEDI PIs, on which Orpson Therapeutics is a partner. So if you can identify SMEs, the EU is into developing SMEs. The last people I'd like to acknowledge, Grace Davey, who she was the program officer on the program manager on the first Red Star. She was crucial then in getting NEPHSTROM put together. I've mentioned Kieran Clisman and Pintail. Steve Elliman is a chief scientific officer in Orpson Therapeutics, another crucial element in putting these together. Colleagues of mine at REMEDI, and then staff of the HRB-funded clinical research facility in Galway. Centre for Cell Manufacturing Ireland is our GMP facility. Galway Blood and Tissue Establishment is in the hospital and is our site of procurement of cells. And then SAILTA, and final mention to the Enterprise Ireland and NCPs. Thank you.
Tim, thank you. A moderator's dream under time. Next up, we'd like to welcome Dr. Sharon Glynn with the School of Medicine. Welcome, Sharon.
Hi, everybody. So I am going to tell you a little bit about myself, first of all. So I'm a translational researcher based in the new Lam Institute for Translational Research here in Galway. I'm also a lecturer in pathology. I am an active researcher myself, but I will be talking about my role as an evaluator in the EU. I have numerous research interests, but they generally are around prostate and breast cancer, and from the point of view of looking at risk factors for the development of cancers and also the treatment as well. That's a list of a couple of my different projects. So just to give you an idea before I go into the EU parts of it, about my own consortium memberships. So I'm a member of the National Prostate Cancer Research Consortium. So this was actually put together by the Irish Cancer Society back in 2011, because there was a lot of individual silos of prostate cancer research around the country without people actually talking with each other. So they did a huge effort to bring this together. And this then kind of led to our membership of the Transdisciplinary Prostate Cancer Partnership, which is a consortium internationally, which includes places like Iceland, Sweden, England, Ireland, the US. So this has been a huge thing for us for being able to, you know, develop our applications into the EU and into the US, etc. So I am part of an interdisciplinary research grant from the Irish Cancer Society. And so this is a mixture of, it's basically a study about looking at metastatic prostate cancer in men. So we are coordinated through Molecular Medicine Ireland. It includes members in UCD, Trinity, and NUI Galway. And from the point of view of actually recruiting all our patients and you know, the data and the biospecimens, et cetera, that's actually run through Cancer Trials Ireland. So we use individual groups based on their strengths to be able to be part of a better group. So that gives you an idea of some of the things that I'm doing. So I acted as a Stage 1 Horizon 2020 evaluator back in 2014. So I thought what I would do is give you an overview of my experiences of it. I can't go into absolute specifics, obviously, because it's confidential. But to give you an idea, so back in 2014, for this particular call, they expected about 100 applications. But when it actually came in, there was 254. But they could only fund 10. So this is one of the first things, I guess. So you're at the stage one, you have to decide who you're going to put through to the next stage. So I myself would have evaluated 25 applications. There was a vast range of different techniques that I had to deal with. Some I'm not necessarily very familiar with, and also a vast range of different disease states. So this would be, my point with this is to just, when you're writing your applications, just remember that not everybody knows as much as you do. So be very, very clear when you're describing your techniques you're using, why they are potentially better than other techniques, and give very good background as well to the disease and why it's important in the context of the EU. So that would be one of the first things I would actually say. The evaluation is equally based on both scientific excellence. The scientific excellence actually includes innovation as well. So it's not enough for the proposal just to be scientifically very sound. It has to be innovative as well. It has to be a step further. And it's also evaluated based on impact. And the score for both is out of 5, and you have to achieve over 4 in both of them. And one of the things I think where people routinely fall down in is actually not putting enough effort into their impact sections. Remember, it's actually 50% of the mark. And just to kind of put that in perspective again, the stage one application form is about 7 pages long. And you wouldn't believe the number of people who only dedicate a half a page to their impact section. So if that's what you're never going to get through. So that's one thing I would say absolutely is emphasize your impact. Then they would have been evaluated by 5 different evaluators, and then they take the median score, and that's how the decision is made as to whether somebody progresses through to stage 2. So just talking a little bit about the excellence and innovation sections. So these are things that I was thinking about it yesterday about what I would actually advise. So I think clarity and specificness of the proposed objectives is incredibly important. So soundness of the concept, like will it improve upon the current state of the art? Will it bring new opportunities? So does it move beyond the state of the art? Does it address transdisciplinary considerations? And I say if relevant, because it's usually very clear in the call, the specific call that you are going for, whether there are transdisciplinary considerations. So address them, address every single point. As the calls are challenge-based, so they're looking for the excellent research and innovation. So that's, I would have mentioned that earlier. Again, your team, is your team suitable? Are all the players needed actually engaged in the application? It's like somebody said earlier, if they're not engaged, you kind of need to get rid of them, because it becomes very, very apparent in the application who contributed and who didn't. And it's, I think it also is putting together applications, it can waste your own time. I've put together ones as well. Does it relate to the work programme? Is your approach sound and is it feasible? Is it achievable? Or does it look like something that you potentially actually wouldn't be achieved within the time frame? Also, another thing I would have noticed would be to make use of technology readiness levels, if relevant to your call, in the project positioning section. You will know if this is relevant to your application when you're putting it together, but make use of these terminologies. Do get to understand the EU terminology. Occasionally as well, for some of the calls, there's requirement for cross-cutting issues, and it's usually explicitly mentioned. If these are mentioned in the call document, address them. So this could include social sciences and humanities within the call, gender dimensions, new strategic approach to international cooperation, but that's usually not relevant at the stage one evaluation, but it should be there. Science education, so these are just examples. So again, read the call document very carefully. So then going back to impact as well, as I said before, it's a 7-page document, so remember to give space to impact. For the impact, it's quite clear what areas they want your proposal to impact upon. So make sure that you address every single type of impact that's listed in the call. So I've just given some examples. For example, if they want the new generation of improved technology. So they want new generation. They don't want you to reuse old for different purposes. So read the English very, very carefully. If they ask for the ability to support SMEs and grow the sector across Europe, make sure that you're addressing that. If it's related to sustainability of healthcare systems, think about how it will improve upon the current systems in place. Maybe also think about the fact as well that the healthcare systems in different countries can be very different and their capacities can be quite different. So kind of integrate into your proposal that you actually address this and think of it internationally across the board. Like especially if, say, you're coordinating from Ireland, don't just go based on the Irish system. So this requires obviously talking to all your partners and thinking about this. So my final tips and advice, so I would just say ensure you address every point across the document, place in the context of the EU and realise that the policies vary across country to country. Where required, make sure you include your industry partners, so these can be both SMEs and also international companies. In relation to international companies, I know my own experiences, you have to give them enough time to be able to come on board with the proposal because they often have to go through their own channels. To be able to get permission to be part of these proposals. So don't go to them with 1 month in advance. They won't be able to help you. Also, in the Horizon 2020, there is no negotiation. So we're instructed as reviewers not to take into account potential amendments. You know, if we're looking at a document, we think, oh, it could be really, really good if they were just to do this and this. That's not a part of it. So it has to all be in there from the very, very start. Ensure that gender is addressed. As I said, impact. And assure you have all partners that you would need to cover every aspect, but don't, again, artificially inflate the partners. So they should be always there for a specific reason. Like if I see 15 partners, but it's quite clear to me that 3 of them have actually got nothing to do with the application, that will make me actually wonder about the application and just how good actually is it. And is there prior evidence perhaps that your team can achieve in both, you know, Horizon 2020 or in other funding calls, like, so do they have a good track record of both funding and publications and show that they are actually capable of doing what they say they're going to do? And I would also say, you know, think about the spread of countries as well that you use, you know, that you don't just stick in one region of Europe, think widely. So those would be my, I guess, experience as an evaluator and also from preparing applications myself, what I would feel is important. So thank you. That's just my list of fundings and my acknowledgements, just people that I work with. So, thank you.
Sharon, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to welcome John O'Dea, who's the CEO and Chair of Crospon Medical Devices and also currently the Chair of our Advisory Board in BioInnovate. So, welcome, John.
Thanks, Paul. Thanks for the invitation. It's very interesting to hear the last speech there from a reviewer's perspective and It's very important, the points that were being made there around impact, I have to say. Anyway, we're Crossbond, we're an Irish medical device SME. To date, we've been involved in 3 projects, 2 FP7, which have been completed, and 1 Horizon 2020, which we're about a year into. Both our projects relate to active drug delivery technology, and we have recently started as a partner in a project led here by NUI Galway called AutoStem. So I'm going to stick to the format too. In terms of partners, networks and consortia, I think the first thing to say is these tend to be large teams, and so I'll speak from a point of view of an SME. It is a different experience when you're dealing with projects that can have seven partners in six countries. You know, you tend to be a lot more focused on the next 12 months in your life of existence as an SME. These are long projects. They're 3-4 year long. You have large teams, and I suppose it's important to bear in mind that this is partaking in these type of projects are not about what happens in your next 12 months. They're much more, or your engagement should be much more strategic in terms of where you're going to be over the next couple of years rather than over the next 12 months. In my experience, what you start to find is that you often end up with partners from previous projects. So, you know, where do you find partners? Well, you often find them from your last project. So if you worked well together, you know, you'll maybe get a call from the project coordinator that coordinated previous projects. And indeed, that's how we got engaged in our second FP7 project. We're an SME, and in the last talk there was mentioned to SME about SMEs and the engagement of SMEs in Horizon 2020. Traditionally, there hasn't been enough SME involvement in the FP7 and Horizon 2020 program, so there's been a big push in Europe to get more SMEs involved. Ultimately, this money has been put in by Europe to for a number of reasons, to address problems, but you don't address problems unless they ultimately are translated into use, and clinical use in this case. So certainly when you have an SME partner, probably they are sitting closer at the D end than the R end of the project, and they are certainly sitting much closer to the commercialization end of the project. And therefore, you know, as an SME, you can bring value to these projects. And I think from a review standpoint, it's probably, not having reviewed projects myself, but it is probably viewed favorably that there's an SME there, because, you know, an SME depends on commercialization and is essentially day-to-day living in the commercialization world. There's been some role in terms of the project management partner. I know when I started back many years ago in the Framework 4, I guess when I started getting involved in this, that, you know, that these project management companies were out there, and I often wondered, really, was there a necessity for them? Like, were they bottom feeders of the whole research system? And I must say my view has translated 180 degrees. I've really come to realize that these partners, if they're good, are hugely, hugely important members of driving the whole projects forward, and indeed maybe driving the submission process forward. Some of them are no foal, no fee. Some of them probably are better. The better ones probably charge you, but they're worth it. I suppose I would say that, you know, it has been mentioned earlier that there is a fair degree of bureaucracy associated with reporting out in the course of these projects, and having somebody that's just bugging you to do that frequently is very, very helpful, because there is a lot of reporting, both financial and from a, you know, interim project reporting standpoint. In terms of the calls and the application process, and we do have a very good national network here in Ireland, and Enterprise Ireland and HRB and so on put out quite regular communications, and they're very, very helpful in terms of highlighting, you know, updates to the work program, and it's very important, obviously, that you read that. You know, what's nice about the program is you can see 3 years in advance what's going to be, what sort of calls are going to be coming out. So it's not like you have to wait for the message to come to say, well, you know, in 3 months' time we're going to be looking for projects in this area. You really have quite a long window to see what's coming when. I know recently there was even from an Irish standpoint, we were asked to feed back on comments on the work plan. I'm not sure where that's at in terms of the feedback or if there's been any amends to that. I'd be interested maybe later on hearing that. But, you know, we as researchers and companies in Ireland have an ability to feed right back into the European work programme. There was an interesting talk earlier, the first talk, about, you know, the technology, ICT manufacturing. I think it's very important in the medical device industry, which I live in, that it's actually not very easy to get funding for medical device work in the health program. It's very pharmaceutically oriented. Obviously, our industry is moving in directions like tissue engineering, which sits very well within the health program. But it's quite challenging to find ways to get funded for medical devices in the health program. Conversely, it's actually where you find this type is in oblique ways in the likes of the ICT program, technology calls, and indeed, you know, there was a talk earlier on, you heard that. So certainly if you're in the medical device area, you may want to look much closer at these areas, because like both, you know, our projects were in active transdermal drug delivery, but actually both of them, none of them were funded in the health program. They were funded in like micromanufacturing for, in our case, microneedles was the big area. And so both our FP7 engagements have actually been in the ICT and manufacturing technology side and not in the health program. And finally, I suppose within some of these technology calls, there's always an interest in demonstrators. So if you're developing a technology, or some of the partners are developing a technology, it's healthy to have a demonstration of that technology in some sort of a vehicle. So in the two we were involved in, actually the main core technology was in micromanufacturing, and you know, microneedles are still a quite new area in terms of drug delivery, and they face quite a significant amount of manufacturing challenges. And like we've all heard of probably microneedles, but in fact to build them reliably in high volume, the techniques are really not that well established. So, and finally, I suppose from an SME standpoint, there's some very powerful funding mechanisms for clinical trials, you know, diagnostics in particular. Certainly I'd like to see more of that. It was very confined to diagnostics in the current Horizon program, but it's a very, very powerful funding mechanism if you're lucky enough to be able to get that funding. So I suppose final tips and advice, if you're getting involved in this area, there is a very, very high burden on documentation and time tracking, particularly time tracking. So very good time management is required. Like typically, you may not have, for instance, all your team working on the project in any given time. You may have two or three different projects going on. So it's very important that you have a good time tracking system. The phasing of the funding, one thing that there's probably not, if you haven't been involved in this before, you may not realize how beneficial the phasing of the funding is, because, you know, generally you will get about 30 to 40% of your money up front. It's not like a grant where often you claim it in retrospect. So for a small company, this is very helpful. You know, you can get involved in this and you can get, you know, paid in advance as distinct from paid in retrospect. So it's very helpful for small companies. I think if you're getting involved in it, don't lead projects initially. Get used to the way the system works. You know, be as I often say, be on the back seat of the bus. Learn the process. And I certainly have been greatly impressed by some of the project management companies out there, including the one that's been mentioned a few times already, in terms of what they bring. I mean, they bring the new around, you know, impact statements, around managing the, you know, the budget tracking, managing the time tracking, and so on. It's probably an you know, there's a lot in this country right now. We're trying to do more interaction between SMEs and third level institutes. This is one of the best reasons I can think of to get in tune with your local third level institution, because they're very good at doing this. I mean, you know, as SMEs, we would be in the 2% rate, but, you know, we heard earlier from the president about the success rate of submissions from the college here. And it is really a very good reason to get to know researchers in your local university. It will help you to build your R&D capacity, you know, by partaking in these type of projects, you really get an opportunity to keep your team a little bit bigger than you might be able to sustain, you know, if you were just doing Project X, and suddenly Project X goes out to the market, you know, now, you know, your focus as an SME is on selling and marketing, and how do you keep that R&D capacity in place? And finally, it gives you an opportunity to broaden your product portfolio. you know, get into areas that you mightn't think of, you know, the incremental change of the current product, get into whole new areas. And, you know, I would envisage that some of the work we have done through a number of these projects will actually take us in very kind of wide broadening of our product portfolio, possibly even having separate spin-off companies. Thank you very much.
John, thank you very much. Next, we'd like to welcome Kay Duggan-Walls to the stage from the HRB. Welcome, Kay.
My name is Kay Duggan-Walls from the Health Research Board, and I'm the national contact point for Horizon 2020 Health. So it's health, demographic change, and well-being. And I'm also the national focal point for another health programme from DG Sante, which is the public health programme. And that's a much smaller co-funded programme. But if people are interested in that, you can contact me about that. And I think there'll be a call open sometime in the new year. And you'll hear more information about that. So my role as national contact point is to raise awareness about the health programme and to support applicants who are applying to the health programme. So just to, I know Stephen did talk about Horizon 2020, and some of the objectives of Horizon 2020 are to tackle global and societal challenges and concerns of citizens and society. It's addressing political priorities of the EU, and it's also an objective is intersectoral and multidisciplinary collaborative research and innovation. So Horizon 2020 is all about multidisciplinary research. And the another objective is that promising solutions need to be tested, demonstrated, and scaled up. So there's also the multidisciplinary nature of the call. So they, that breakthrough solutions come from multidisciplinary collaborations, including social sciences and humanities. And also Horizon 2020 is a means to drive economic growth and create jobs by coupling research and innovation. And here is where the SMEs are very important. And you may look at the health work programme and see that they don't specifically mention SMEs. They may in a few, but I think it's important that you do look beyond the impacts in the stated in the work programme for something that may eventually become need to be commercialised or something that will come out of the work you're doing. So it is important to think ahead and because one of the aims is to, you know, to create jobs and growth from the health work or from the whole of Horizon 2020. So I thought I'd just talk to you about the health work programme as well, because it gives you an idea of the perspective of it. So the main goal is better health for all, and this means translating science to benefit citizens, improving health and well-being outcomes, supporting a competitive health and care sector, testing and demonstrating new health and care models, approaches and tools, and it's promoting healthy and active ageing, and it's also promoting the EU as a global leader in the health area. So these are the objectives of the health programme. So when you're looking at the calls, these are the kind of things you should bear in mind. Now, I was looking at the health work programme, and it's all about multidisciplinary research, and then the title of today's talk is interdisciplinary. So multidisciplinary brings together numerous experts from diverse disciplines collectively address a complex problem. So I think that's what they're looking for in Horizon 2020. And then interdisciplinary is the process of combining two or more disciplines to create a new interdisciplinary science, such as bioengineering or biophysics. So I suppose we're kind of looking at multidisciplinary research in the health programme. Now, as Patricia said earlier on, the Commissioner are doing a lot of work to include social sciences and humanities. And in the National Support Network, we've worked with our colleagues in the IRC as well to include more of the social sciences and humanities in the different work programmes. And the Commission have said that under Horizon 2020, the social sciences and humanities are given an enhanced role as a cross-cutting issue aimed at improving our assessment and response to the complex societal issues. So that where relevant, the research and innovation chain should include contributions from the social sciences and humanities. So they're talking about sociology, economics, psychology, political science, history, and cultural sciences. So I suppose that would apply to any of the calls. And one of the examples that the Commission are highlighting, and this was a 2014 call that was funded, and one of the partners from Trinity was involved in this project, and they highlight this as one of the, you know, interdisciplinary ones where social sciences is included. So it was integrating biology, statistics, epidemiology, epigenomics approaches, and social science approaches, and sociology, economics, and public health policies were what were included. And the topic was about the interaction between the genetic makeup of individual human beings and behavioural and environmental factors. So this is one of the ones that where they feel that they have a success in including the social sciences and the humanities. And how they've given some examples of how to include social sciences and humanities in the health work programme, but I mean, this would apply to, I suppose, any of the other areas that would want to be working together. And one of the pieces of advice that, you know, it needs to be initiated upstream and not simply considered as an add-on. So any interdisciplinary work or multidisciplinary work, you need to work together, not added on at the end. And it's important to check the level of the integration between the STEM researchers and the social sciences, and also the level of rigour of the application of the social sciences research. And also it needs to go beyond health economics to include all of the other areas that you might want to include in the project. And then they have, over the health work, or over all of Horizon 2020, they have flagged topics that are where social science and humanities can be included. So you take into account the social, economic, behaviour, and so on, cultural dimensions, and to include them into the various stages of the proposal. So I thought what we could do is take a look at the Horizon 2020-2016-17 work programme, and just to look through where you could see where there are multidisciplinary requirements in the calls. Now the 2016 calls are closed, but just gives you an example of the kind of how broad they are and how they have changed very much from FP7. So in the first one here, networking and optimising the use of population and patient cohorts at EU level, you're talking about public health, socioeconomic research, you're talking about ICT platforms, social platforms, new types of data, geographical, genetic, e-health records, and then engagement with national, international, regional authorities. And the next one, it's all about public engagement, dissemination, communication, training, epidemiological surveys, capacity building, best practice, and in new therapies for chronic diseases involving patients and taking their views into account wherever relevant, and not just at the end, but right through the project. I should have said at the outset that the health work programme is, I suppose, in its nature, it's multidisciplinary because you have two directorates from the Commission involved, because you have the whole half of the programme is ICT for health and the projects that were highlighted earlier on, and some other later on have been successful in this area, in the health area. In the first one there, e-health innovations in empowering the patient, there's all the whole area of user acceptance of IT-based technologies. And these are, all of these are the words that are in the work programme. So you can see that there is, you know, you're asked to include all of these things, you know, that you're asked to include all the different disciplines. So, and they talk there in this one on the EU-Japan cooperation, they're talking about multidisciplinary research involving behaviour, sociological health, and then again cost effectiveness, interests and lifestyles of older people, reducing isolation and loneliness, and then the next one, implementing research for scaling up evidence, best innovations and good practice, and that the impact should be broad, addressing economic and social benefits as well, and the proposals should be multidisciplinary. So they're actually asking you to do that. So when you're in the looking at the work programme, look at it very, very carefully, go through it and see where you can get involved. And quite often, I know from our discussions with the social science and humanities people as well, you know, they may not, you know, the person, maybe the STEM researcher who's leading the project may not see where they can fit in, but I think it's up to you to go through the work programme, see where you could fit and see what you can bring of value to the call. I won't go through these, I see there isn't much time, but most of these calls are now closed, except for some of the 2017, which some of them are two-stage, so they're closing early next month. So all of these, again, have the same, you know, talking about socioeconomic impact, health, and all of these kind of areas. So the other thing I was asked to do was, you know, how you can find partners, and there's a very good website, Fit for Health, and they also organise partnership events. And on that website, you can publish your profile, publish your project, and find partners. And they organise brokerage events, like I was saying, and Jane had told me that she, I had given her, I told her about the ICT event, and she had met the partner that now she's in a consortium with. So these things do work. It's also good to look at previously funded Horizon 2020 health projects. There are a lot of them, and you could look also in ICT or Marie Curie, and to see what kind of projects, you know, that have been funded that are multidisciplinary. You can look at your own colleagues, you know, international and national, and in other disciplines as well, not just in health. And these are the final tips. So start preparing early as soon as the draft work programme is available. Talk to your NCP, the colleagues in university, or previously funded researchers. And they're always very helpful to tell you about their work and what they have done and their the road that they have travelled. So look at the work programme in detail, download the call, register as soon as the call is open, and check the deadlines. And I know Patricia did mention that we have the scoping paper, but I have it here, so anybody wants to talk to me about the scoping paper. And we did, as John was saying, we did send out the advisory group report, and the Commission have then sent a scoping paper, and they're working now on the new work programme for the next 3 years. So there are my contact details, and thank you very much.
Hey, thank you very much. We'd like to welcome Dr. Adamantios Koumpis to the podium, please, from the University of Passau. Welcome, Adamantios.
So, research, the fundraising, and everything. Some facts about me. Actually, I'm in this business since the previous century, and the first time that I was involved in proposal writing was back in 1989, and I have professionally started doing this since 1993. So it's now about 27 or 23 years that I do this with no interval, no time that I stopped doing it. And I know that there are other people that are doing some similar thing, and it's something that people can get seriously addicted in it. What Valerie wrote in one of her emails about the funding process, not specific projects as such. And another thing is that actually, what is called gambler's fallacy occurred, as it is said, only once in a game of roulette in Monte Carlo, where the ball fell in black 26 times in a row, which means that to have success been replicated is, in many cases, too expensive. Now, some things that I think that I have learned in all these years. It's, first of all, it's that people matter more than their ideas. And the story matters more than the actual research or innovation one has in mind. This is a pity, and at some extent it allowed that some type of cargo cult research is now fostered. The term I intended to use this term, cargo cult, but I found out that it was also the same term that it was used by Richard Feynman, but not in relation with research, but in relation with science. Now, success may simply happen, but it is better if one plans for success or engineers it to happen. And as I said, it's usually very difficult to replicate a success. And in many cases, people might have been invited in a proposal, and this proposal wins. And then, for the first time that they have ever applied. And then they see how difficult it is to come up with a second successful project. And at some point, they try to find different ways
to, for instance, to approach the right partners or develop a network of contacts. At the end, what I mentioned as a second bullet is there that networking is very important. On the other hand, there is nothing worse than people who are skilled in networking and are continuously meeting people in events like the one that takes place in Bratislava that Steve mentioned before, and they may have zero own ideas, zero own intellectual capital, zero aspects of character or ethos, but they are very skilled in meeting other people and somehow finding a place for them to be in consortia. So at the end, if someone seriously intends to, as an academic, scientist, or researcher, to stay in this area or in this business, it's very good if one invests in having their own ideas, their own research, that they are actually their intellectual, intangible assets that they can use or trade when being part of a consortium. Soft skills can be learned. Sometimes they matter more than other ones, and in many cases, for these soft skills, it may take some years till one learns them. Which brings me to the next slide, and it may take about 5 or more years till someone learns the game. And there is this 10,000-hour rule in a book by Malcolm Gladwell, I think, and I know that this 10,000-hour rule has been criticized, so it may not be the case, but the thing is that it needs intensive effort and continuity so that people learn how to cope with this proposal business. And during these years, one person's character may be put under extreme stress. So there are always communication difficulties when working with people from other cultures and backgrounds. And this can bring people seriously to their limits. And the nature of the project is also different than the relations that one has with their PhD students. And the issue is what happens afterwards. So what does one learn after having reached their limits? First of all, something that was mentioned also before. It's the best for a project to hire professional project managers. I know that the temptation is very high to hire a postdoctoral researcher that will be doing research also, but a project needs professional hired guns, so to say, to carry out all the communications, deal with all bureaucracies, administrative things, reporting. So it would be really a waste of effort and resources of a researcher or a scientist to devote themselves into doing all these things. Now, the thing there is that, as I write, is that avoid hiring alpha science or researchers. They may not give a damn about your proposal or project, which means that in this respect, if I were a postdoctoral researcher and my professor would hire me for a project, I would mainly care about my publications, my next steps, so I would be very happy to use the proposal and the project so that I will be paid, but I would not necessarily care very much about the project, or I might not care at all. So it's good to find professional project managers. Now, another good thing is that, I think I mentioned this here, or it's in the next slide, I think, or I intended to write about this, but the thing is that usually, it's here, it's the last bullet, that from the professional project manager, first of all, there are some ones that look very successful, but if one looks a little deeper, they can find out that they may have never run a project completely, or they may have only been involved in some phase of the project, so they are seriously lacking in-depth experience and knowledge. And another thing with professional project managers that I feel, okay, it may be used as a rule of thumb, but I think that you can find better project managers that will cost you less, which means that here it's not something that you have to pay much money to get a good professional project manager. You can afford to find project managers that are really very good and cost less money than you have been thinking. Now, the difference between being a coordinator in a project or a simple partner for me means only that you will get more or less, about 150 or 200,000 euros. But the thing is that you will have a much calmer period of your life, so you will have really quality of life, because coordinating a project is really something that is really a stressful thing. And because at some point, all partners try to avoid being seriously engaged in the project. And on the other hand, there is the commission. And it's something that it's not a pleasant thing. Now, if one considers this extra money, which is always good, but actually you will need to use this money to hire professional project managers, there is no space to regard that you have a net profit if you coordinate a project. Of course, it may seem like a good thing in one person's career. But the thing is that, 2 minutes left. I think that, okay, I will play my slides, because I thought that I was given this limit of 3-4 slides, and I had 8. But I think that I made all these trip from Germany. I think it's worth that I will violate this rule, yeah? And the other thing there is that a project funding can be always used as some investment, as an infrastructure to build sustainable relationships and help build a network of good people for the future. So it's the network that is the asset, the end. Yeah? Now, funding calls and the application process. Work for a proposal may start much earlier, but it is the last weeks usually that make the difference. Now, the pros of early planning is that things are not left to happen in the last moment, while the cons of early planning is that momentum can be any time lost and may not be regained or be regained with a big difficulty. Now, it's same as what they say about the village and to raise a child, that it takes a village. It's also a team to come up with a good proposal. So a proposal that has been written by only one person or two or three may have serious potential to fail. So some usual mistakes to avoid: the coordinator ending up preparing financial tables or caring for the email list. So it's good if the coordinator of a proposal will care only about the content, the story, and have a team of people who will support them on these other tasks. People spend endless time in Skype, or if they afford to do this, even in face-to-face meetings. I don't think that a proposal needs too many Skypes. The story can be documented on paper, and what I see is that people tend to spend too much time in Skypes, and then they fail to write down something so that for the next week's Skype they have some real progress. And in that case, it's very unpleasant to say that, why haven't you done anything, but you are always willing to spend or waste time in Skype. People spend all their energy in writing emails, so this is similar to the case of Skype, or annotating other person's contributions with comments. I see how many people tend to comment what I may have written, but try to avoid putting any effort in contributing. So this, again, may be not a good sign. I think that I said that I will say what I intend to say, yeah? So, but this makes me a little nervous, which may, at the end, cost a little more time, yeah. With a proposal still not in a stable, consistent, or complete form, people start talking about the money. So I think that the money is an issue that can be dealt at the end or some days before the submission. So it's not worth at all to have people talking about resources in an early stage, and as long as the proposal is still in an incomplete form. Mistakes to avoid: partners who care for their budget and resources, and once they learn the figures, they ask for more. Partners who send their profile only. So in this case, I don't know whether you would like to kick out a partner who doesn't care about the proposal or keep them because they are a big name. But I think that no one would care if a partner is a big name. Currently, The Commission cares and in the evaluation process mainly about well-written proposals, even if they are from some small university that nobody knows in Brussels. Partners who will destroy the morale of the team with their behavior. Okay, for me, it's isolate them and kick them out as soon as possible. Now, on the interdisciplinarity, it's a costly business. By simply putting together people from different disciplines doesn't guarantee good music, and this is not interdisciplinarity. People who are involved in the interdisciplinary process need to learn and respect each other's backgrounds. This is not as easy or usual as we tend to think. Learning is less difficult than respect, while respect the other disciplines is a precondition for learning. I can say from my experience from IT that when IT people tend to work with people, let's say with humanities people, not necessarily with people from health, the humanities people don't respect the IT people because they think that everything is an app or something. And for the IT people, they think that at the end it's about data or files or text, so they don't care about to learn a little more about what the humanities people deal with. So, however, what usually happens is that people with different backgrounds coexist within the same projects and fake this or present this as interdisciplinarity. So, some final tips, and this is the last slide. So, yeah, I will. What I think I did right all these years, I exhibited the same enthusiasm as when I started. Now, enthusiasm is very important, is a key. In this respect, in many cases, I prefer to work together with people who have no experience, so some students, some master students, who may be enthusiastic about the process, than with people who are very bored or feeling depressed that, okay, yet another failure, that we will spend our Christmas time writing a proposal that will fail. So enthusiasm is key. So if someone doesn't have enthusiasm, it's a lost story from the beginning. In this respect, there are many calculative players or cold-blooded tacticians. I think that it's not worth to have them in this adventure. What I think I did wrong all these years, I overvalued, in many cases, people's wish to seriously commit effort and engage themselves there. And what mistake I hope I shall avoid making is to undervalue people. There is always some good partners out there that it's only a matter to discover them. So many thanks. Yeah? And sorry for being.
Thank you very much. And our last speaker for this session, I'd like to welcome Dr. Catherine Halbert, the founder and director of Halbert Research. And just to note, we will have a couple of minutes for brief questions after Catherine's talk and before lunch.
Thank you. I'm not from Pintail, I feel I should say that. So I run a company called Halbert Research, and we help coordinators and researchers and people working in industry to develop their proposal ideas and write proposals, hopefully win the funding and then manage projects afterwards. So the services that we offer, I guess, come out of my own experience initially as a researcher in botany and then food science and technology, and working as a lowly postdoc trying to apply for funding to be sure I had a job or a contract for the next year, to going on then to getting the funding and managing projects, to being an evaluator for the Commission, which I've been doing since 2002. And I suppose working as an evaluator made me look at things, and as Sharon pointed out, lots of tips earlier about how you look at a, when you're writing a proposal afterwards, you will look at it completely differently. And then through working with the Commission, working on reviewing projects and some projects that are having problems, as well as the really good projects, and then looking at impact assessment. And I'm on the external advisory board for Societal Challenge too, because that fits with my area, food and agriculture. So looking at the planning that goes into the topics and what the Commission expect, and looking back at what is being delivered and are they meeting their targets and so on. So the services that I offer come from that background of being involved at the different stages and understanding the things that can go wrong. And I guess the first thing I should say is I find it an exciting and fun process, and especially at the beginning, if I can get in there early with a group when the creativity is happening And you've got some fantastic tips already from the other speakers, but you know, you need that space and you need that time to actually bounce ideas off each other and put your proposal together. And that's the fun bit that sometimes people don't have because they're starting too late. And you know, I know when I walk into the room, if there's a bit of a scramble and there's a lot of confusion and people have different ideas about what the project's going to be about, you know, the radar and the alarm bells go off then that, okay, we need to slow things down and maybe work backwards to what the concept is and so on. But it should be something that you're planning for. It's a project in itself when you're writing a proposal. And it needs that respect of timing and scheduling and thinking time and listening to people, as earlier speakers said. So I've just a few slides, and I'm running a facilitation or networking session in the afternoon where we're going to be working through some of this, but finding the right call. And you know, the Horizon 2020 website, I shouldn't say this because I'll get into trouble with the Commission, but it is something like that was produced out of a Framework 5 project, you know. It's not intuitive and it's difficult to use and it's difficult to find things. But if you have the call identifier, you know, just go in and look at that call and just focus on that text. And every word that's on that text is there for a reason. It's been put forward by people in an advisory board, like the one I'm in for Food and Agriculture, programme committees, people in the Commission. They've pored over every single word. And sometimes at the last minute, between the scoping paper and the programme, other things get shoved in and topics get merged, and you can end up sometimes with very not very sensible topics. But look at your call and analyse the text. And the first thing I usually do is make a checklist out of it and use bold. It's the same text, but I'm taking it out of that work programme where it's just one big long narrative, and just really breaking it down so that when we're having our first meeting, we're ticking everything off. And we'll find, you know, we don't have a health economist, or we don't have someone specialising in gender, or we don't have a sociologist, because we know when we're reading the call that's what it is required. And we're talking about interdisciplinary research today, and I mean, it is built into the topics. I mean, that's what the Commission is trying to achieve. And if you find yourself struggling, that you don't know how to do a particular piece of that call, that's a good thing, because that means you're going to go out and find new partners to do that. So if somebody sends me a call identifier, the first thing I do is do the checklist, and then I send them a one-page proposal template. So we have one for the different programs, and that's quite useful because it helps them to actually figure out what it is they're doing. Even just writing the title and the aim and the objectives and who the end users of the results will be can help them to try to build their concept. And from that, then, you can draw out the project structure. And by that, I mean just a flip chart with pens or a bit of paper, boxes and arrows, and trying to place the different elements of your project. It sounds very boring and mechanical, but you have to use those steps. And you know you're onto a winner when you've got a brilliant idea. So we've heard some brilliant ideas today. So, you know, I was got already at the professional soccer teams and the exercise and involving people in a project in that way, or working with people using the avatar that was described earlier and so on. So I'm already excited about that idea and convinced by it. And if you're an evaluator, if you can get that feeling at the beginning of the project, you're with it the whole way and you're sort of ignoring minor little errors, but you're positively disposed towards it. So the structure takes time, and that's where the creativity comes in. And you work with a small team first, people you can trust that are experts, to get the structure right. You don't have a big consortium meeting where you're all trying to figure out what the hell is happening. You have something done in advance that you can actually present, and then you can widen out your consortium to bring in people who may not be work package leaders, for example. But you will have gaps at the beginning and you'll be looking for partners. Well, people say to me, you know, well, we're not having any meetings, we're doing everything by Skype. Just think, okay, this is not going to work. You have to meet people, and you have to, I mean, the president was saying earlier about Galway being well disposed and the university here in terms of where it's located, and it's surrounded by companies and it's an interdisciplinary university and so on. And if you don't have that luxury, you need to get out of your lab and out of the library and out of the gates of the college, and you've got to go to where the other researchers are and the companies are and so on to actually build up your consortium. But if you don't have a meeting face-to-face, you'll find it extremely difficult to write a winning proposal. And you know the minute people come into the room, whether they're going to be problematic or they're not very communicative or you don't understand what they're talking about, if they're talking about big data or mathematics. And that's very important because you need that good communication when you're writing the proposal. And bring in advisors that sit in on the meeting, because if you're not an IT, I'm not an IT person, so sometimes I find it difficult to understand what it is they do and what they need to know from me or what they actually, what the potential is, because I'm not sure what it is they do. Bring in advisors who are in IT to assess that partner at that first meeting, to be able to say to you, yes, they understand what you need, they're high quality and so on. Because if that's not your core expertise and you win the project, you'll have difficulty trying to assess if that person is doing good work or not. And halfway through the project, and I've had that experience, you realise they're not giving you what you thought because you weren't able to assess it. So matching the concept to the call and picking out who the work package leaders are, this is just very simple rules that I follow. And then talking about money at the very first meeting. And you must have a rough budget done out in your head. You know, we're going to put 8% towards management and 6% towards dissemination, and X percent of the budget has to go to the clinical trials. What does that leave us with? How many partners do we have? And you just do a very rough estimate. You present that at the first meeting, and everybody gets really annoyed that they're getting a small budget. But you say, OK, come back and convince me when you have your tasks written out, the budget that you do need. But you must have some configurations done in advance. And the same with intellectual property. Who owns what and what their intentions are. And if you don't get them to document that for you in the early days, people have expectations that you may not have understood about what they may own at the end of the project. And just, Sally said it earlier, about sitting back and listening and observing partners and just seeing, is this going to be a good team? Will this work for me if you're the coordinator? Finally, when you're writing the proposal, okay, once you get to, this is the easy bit, if you've done everything else right in advance. This is the mechanical act of putting everything together. If you have good people and it's a brilliant idea and you're matching the call, you've got the right partners, it's just a matter of writing it well. And I don't mean, you know, exaggerating the story or trying to pretend it's going to have an impact that it won't have. You know, it must be solid that when you actually go to do the writing, it falls together well. And I just want to say something about impact. And I was reading last night, I suppose, preparing, thinking about this in interdisciplinary research. And a fundamental researcher might say, look, I've got to make up something about impact. But really, I don't believe in it myself because I feel what I'm doing is quite long term. It's more about context. So if you're trying to think of the impact of what you're doing, it's the context of your work in the wider world. And you know, that might take 10 years or it might be in 12 months' time. And I think sometimes we get stuck on impact, but if we just think, what's the context of what we're doing and why is it meaningful and for other people? Just the last point I'll make is, and I'm in a room of exceptional researchers and research leaders, it is not all about the science. I'm assuming the science is going to be excellent. Okay, it's when you're writing the proposal and managing the project, it's how well it's going to be managed and that you deliver something tangible that actually can be used and we get you that impact that you set out at the beginning. So in the afternoon, we'll have a session here where we'll go through some of these processes, working with some of the existing topics. Okay, thank you.
Fascinating perspectives today and from a variety of sides, both as reviewers and applicants, and some very common themes around people and timing and project management and reporting, which I'm always terrified of with European grants because I feel like you're cutting the stick with which to beat yourself. Just to ask the panelists, which would you rate as the number one out of all of those sort of watch-outs or those common themes? Which is the most important, do you think, in getting into one of these multidisciplinary and multi-institutional approaches? Is it the right people? Is it the right science? Is it the right project management team? What would you rate as the number one to the wide panel?
That it's going to engage people. For me, I mean, that's what will jump out as an evaluator, the very first page I read. And I think that's a crucial factor to get in. And sometimes some of the proposals can be quite boring and dull,
because they don't manage to get that excitement and motivation across.
That's a wonderful perspective. Any other points from the panelists on that one, Tim?
It's all of the above, really. But I think the paragraph that they have, that description, and people have alluded to the fact that every word in it is crucial, and it really is. It's dense, and it's really... And to put forward a proposal which convincingly suggests that there's going to be a high-impact delivery on what the call is, call's objective is. But that requires project management science, a good statement on impact, as Sharon was saying, not 30, you know, half a page at the end. But that paragraph and addressing that paragraph in an innovative and impactful manner.
Thank you. And I know from my own experience collaborating across Europe and the US and Ireland, it's also people, finding the right people to work with is certainly key to some of the initiatives we do. If there are any questions from the audience, please put up your hand and we'll have the mic for you. Tim, maybe just picking up on a point you made in your talk, talking about failure. I think we've all had experience in applying for grants and not having them funded, unfortunately. Maybe some of the key learnings from failure or the thoughts from any of the panelists on some of the key learnings from failure, like what is the most useful part of that? I suppose our methodology in bioinnovate is fail fast, fail early, learn from it, and kind of move on. So I'm just curious as to the panelists' perspectives on failure and the learnings from that, and I think maybe some of the room might be as well. Anybody want to... tackle that one?
I suppose I'm glad I'm remembered for failure. But yeah, there were lots of them, and there will continue to be lots of them. And I suppose it's important not to let that dissuade one from going forward again. SME input and project management were two major, you know, between failure and success for me, and some of it's luck as well, but having good SME partners and really good project management in order to package your, I think Catherine mentioned, it's not all about the science, which scientists are kind of sometimes not used to handling. It's how you package it, present it, and so I think good project management help from the very beginning is really important, as well as really relevant SME engagement.
Fantastic, thank you, Jim. More comments from this side.
I think maybe to do with failure. So I think, say when you're starting out as an early investigator, expect to fail a lot at the start because grantsmanship is a learning process. So that would be one thing I would say. Next, I would say when you're looking at the reviews that you get back, I usually scan them and then I shut it down and then I come back a week later so I'm not too angry. And so that would be one of my first things. And then I would look through it in detail and I, you know, look at different points. Some of them I will agree with, others I won't. So I take from it what I want. It can be quite handy as well because it might be something you had put in but you didn't give it enough detail and you kind of left a gap there that they couldn't understand. So you learn from it but you move on and remember as well a lot of the time it just depends on who read it on the day and you know what their opinions are. So you could send it to a different panel a different day and they could love it, another day they'll hate it. So don't take it personally, just keep going.
Just one point there, I think it's important to recognise that lots of very good proposals fail to get funded because there's just never enough money to go around. And, you know, we're seeing proposals getting 14 out of 15 and they're just coming up short because, you know, the cut-off point was 14 and a half or maybe it was 15 out of 15. So, you know, it's a difficult pill to swallow when you're up at that level. You've got 14 and a half out of 15. How do you improve on that without damaging the proposal, you know? So I think... you know, you need to look at the bigger picture here when you're putting these proposals together, when you're working with your collaborators around Europe, you know, what can you get outside of the proposal if it's not funded? You know, if it's a commercial entity going in, if it's an SME, are there other companies in there maybe that you can do something with on a commercial level outside of the proposal, you know? So I think you need to try and benefit as much as you can from it, but, you know, bear in mind, look, that there were so many different entities chasing this money. It's the hit rates are poor, and good proposals won't always get there.
Thank you. Okay,
I suppose on a positive note, I think it was John who was saying, you know, not to go in as a coordinator straight away, but I know that in health in FP7 we had a number of people who went in for the first time as coordinators, and I think if you have a good idea and you see a topic that's perfect for you, you should go for it, because you just don't know whether you'll be successful or not. And I don't, and often we hear people saying, who are the big groups that are applying in Europe? But I don't think you need worry about them. You do your project and your idea, and I think, if you know, that you should just go for it. I think it's important.
No, I think that's an important message, and pick up, I think, what Catherine said, you know, if it's a good idea, go for it and put that forward.
Just a very quick point, that when you're, because there's no negotiation anymore, when you're writing your proposal, you are actually writing the project. And I've had the experience of when we got funded, so it was successful, but I looked at my own work package and I thought, did I write that task? And I was going to deliver that in 3 months. And it's, you know, when you write a proposal, it can be all very theoretical, but write it as a project, because you've got to deliver on it. And just the last point is, sometimes very simple proposals get through because they're very focused and they're not being overcomplicated, and they're not trying to throw in too much into the one project. And very clean, simple projects get through because of that, because the evaluator can that they're appealing and they do meet the topic, but don't try to overcomplicate things because you have to deliver afterwards.
Okay, thank you. I suppose just in relation to all the questions that have been asked, from an evaluation perspective, it has to be the idea, and it has to be simple and easily communicated. From a carrying out the work, it has to be the people that you put on your team. That's so you have the idea to convince the reviewers, but you have to have the people to do the work. So that's really important. And in relation to the concept of failure, if you really believe in the science and what you're doing, you will get it funded. You will definitely get it funded. You will always get it funded. And it may be that that particular funding mechanism isn't the right one. And what you gain from meeting other people who believe in that research question that you're trying to get funded is so valuable from a learner. And we're all learners, we're all researchers. That is so valuable. So it shouldn't all hang on the getting it funded or not. There's so much that can be learned and gained that you will bring back to other areas of your work and your life experience that are beyond just the funding.
I agree, and thank you, John.
If I could make one point, I suppose present company accepted, but you know, when you do fail, what can be frustrating is when you get feedback like "could be better," quote unquote. The review process isn't necessarily going to be tremendously helpful to help you understand what you should be doing better. And I mean, I think if I would feed that back even from a national standpoint, that, you know, I think there is a responsibility in reviewers to maybe do a little more to help guide what, because we all are going to go back in again probably if we believe in something.
Yeah, there's little as frustrating as a bland review with no information. Tim, did you want to pick them up?
I just wanted, just as a point, it's interesting because things like, you know, if you apply to Irish Cancer Society, HRB, Welcome, and that, the review process, the reviewers, you know, do give advice and potentially what can make the project stronger. But when you're an EU evaluator, you're actually told not to say what they should do to make it better. We're not allowed. So we can only say what we think is good. You know, or where, you know, if it didn't necessarily address the challenges, or if we felt it wouldn't advance the field, but we actually can't make suggestions. So it is one thing to bear in mind when you get your reviews back from EU projects. I think it's a bit unfortunate, but it's what we're told to do.
I think that's good for everyone to know. If there aren't any more questions from the room, is there one more comment? Sorry.
I just have a question really for the speakers. I thought it was very helpful to hear Kay and Patricia in particular speak of the differences and the subtleties between the integration of arts, humanities and social sciences into kind of STEM projects versus interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary research. But I kind of wanted to come back then to the whole objective of today and an interdisciplinary research and Molly's objective to unite the existing islands that are here. The question for the speakers really is, how can we at an institutional level help catalyze interdisciplinary collaborations? Any thoughts from
I suppose from the medical device standpoint, I mean, traditionally we've all been involved in devices that are made and used in hospitals a lot of the time. You know, with the big emphasis on aging in the program right now, I think we as an industry have to broaden our focus to the social aspects of health in the home, health in the aged, and the medical conditions that are associated with aging that may be independent of the actual technology or device that you're using. So I do believe there's an important opportunity. I mean, just something as simple. I mean, a few years ago I was involved in a project around a home dialysis machine. And, you know, traditionally we go out to industrial design firms and we come up with these Star Trek looking devices. And really what became apparent to me is that, you know, if you have a chronic condition that requires daily dialysis, you don't necessarily want to be advertising that to everyone that comes in your house. In fact, something that sits within a bedside locker that you don't even know it's there. From, you know, it occurred to me that working with the likes of the furniture design people in letter frack, or you know, that we need to stop thinking about devices as glitzy looking things. In fact, the best device in a home care environment you shouldn't even see there. And I think also the you know, the whole social dimension around the use of devices in the home, I do believe there's opportunities we're only starting to better understand.
Probably worth the institutions putting a seed fund together to fund interdisciplinary programs within the university. And so I'd have my suggestion is a money-based one. You have to put money aside and see if you can get somebody from arts and humanities to engage in some project with some other area and fund them.
Wonderful.
Sure.
I suppose it's interesting to see Sally Wyke's post in the University of Glasgow as a professor of interdisciplinary research. And I wonder in terms of, I don't know, is Sally still in the room? I don't think she is. Anyway, it might be just interesting to explore what they've done in other places as possible solutions to that infrastructure.
So I'm still here, and sorry. Not at all. I didn't hear the question though.
So we were talking about Anne from the research office was asking about infrastructural measures that we could take, or institutional measures that we could take to facilitate interdisciplinary collaboration with a view to applying for these kinds of applications. And I was wondering, in terms of your role as interdisciplinary research professor, whether that has been a useful experience or something maybe that at an institutional level you think has been useful to promote those kinds of collaborations.
Yeah, well, my university, interdisciplinary has been on the table for years, hasn't it? At least the last five to seven years in terms of research funding. So I've been fortunate in that my post was created to bridge social science and health research in the population health, public health, primary care arena rather than in the biomedical sciences. So that's why I am. That's why my post was created. So interdisciplinarity is just taken for granted. But like everybody has said so far, it's not easy. And what that means is not easy. Now, getting one of these EU awards, however, I could easily, and for other funders, that's what you do. You work within an institution. You want to keep all the money to your own institution, but you can't do that with the EU. So actually finding the collaborating partners in other universities in other European countries was absolutely critical. I could have probably done all of this within Glasgow, but not if you want EU funds. I don't know whether that helps. So what has my institution done? And what do others do? Actually, things like town hall meetings are useful, where you've got, like Catherine said, a particular topic, which is a problem, and multiple perspectives on how to address it, including from the anthropologists and from the arts and humanities folk. That kind of thing does work sometimes. Not too many of them, but